Oh, there are these woke teachers everywhere, nonstop. Here's one who thought it would be a good idea to make a little video on TikTok debunking a argument that no one's ever made before.
So, a response to Republicans whenever you say we should teach about slavery or the genocide of indigenous people in the classroom is, "Oh, well, it happened so long ago. Why do we have to? Why do they need to know? Why does anyone need to know?" Okay, why do you learn about the Holocaust? Why do you learn about the Rwandan genocide? Why do you learn about imperialism? Why do you learn about the Enlightenment? Why do you learn about the Soviet Union? Why do you learn about the American Revolution? Why do you learn about the Civil War? All those things were in the past. Why do we learn about them? It's almost as though there's a class you take in school where you talk about things that happened in the past. Wait a minute. Wait. This is all making too much sense, right? It's too much. No.
There's no person ever has said we should not teach slavery and what happened in school. I want to go to Ruth Edmonds, former NAACP president of in Columbus, Ohio, and now she's running for Congress. Miss Edmonds, how are you today?
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me
Really,
on.
that's really good to talk to you. I want to know more about your story. And then I will get back to exactly what that teacher was talking about, but what made you join the NAACP and then rise the ranks to president?
Interestingly enough, I'm originally from the inner city of Baltimore, Maryland, born and raised by my grandmother, who only had a fourth grade education. And yet she taught us the values and the principles of hard work, perseverance, faith in God, taking advantage of opportunities that come, and not to make excuses for barriers that come your way. Those principles and values shaped who I was. And after I graduated from college, I was introduced to the Columbus branch of the NAACP by one of its vice presidents approaching me at the television station I was working at and asking, "What do you do when you're not at work?" And I said, "Well, I just graduated from college." And little did I know, but that administration was actually a Republican-led administration of the NAACP in Columbus. And by spending time with those leaders, those African American Republican leaders, I came to understand that my principles and my values really more aligned with the Republican platform of faith, family, freedom, individual liberties, and economics, free economics, and so that's how. And so that was the late 80s, and I've been a
Yeah.
registered Republican ever since.
Is that a thing, like a Republican branch of the NAACP?
No, it's not. As a matter of fact, the NAACP is supposedly a nonpartisan organization, and so we actually were the fulfillment of of that organization, of the mission and the vision of the organization.
As opposed to the rest of the groups, which are pretty far on the left, you're saying. Tell me more about your grandma. What? How did she teach you these values? Was she a good lecturer, or did she live them herself? What did you see?
Oh yeah, her name was Pearl, and so therefore I've been wearing pearls throughout this campaign in honor of her. No, she was just a common sense woman from Richmond, Virginia, and how she taught us was through the things that she would say to us, like, "Own your stuff." The same as don't make excuses. She said, "You may one day be better off, but you're never going to be better than anybody." So, maintain some humility. And and the one other thing she would say to us if we woke up feeling a little groggy and not wanting to go to school, she'd say, "Oh, baby, go on to school. And if you're that sick, the teacher will send you home." Because even with a fourth grade education, she understood that education was the gateway out of poverty. And so it was through her life, taking us to church, introducing us to God. It was the life that she lived that taught us how to be good citizens, good people in the earth, appreciating people, regardless, no matter what the color of their skin was, we were taught to appreciate and value and associate with just good people.
Yeah, see, what you just described is such a perfect example of how culture transcends politics. Should.
Yes.
But that's such a beautiful story right there. That's so perfect and that's so universal. And skin color means absolutely nothing to what you just said right there. That's so good. What do you say to the critical race theory that's being taught in our schools today? What would you like it to be replaced with?
Well, first of all, let's be clear that critical race theory, thanks be to God, is not being taught everywhere. And I'm so excited about the parents who are standing up and speaking out against those times when there are some school districts that are trying to indoctrinate their children. Listen, critical race theory is just that. It is a theory. It has not been proven. It's not factual. It's a thought. And it's one man or two men or women's thoughts. And quite frankly, it's even becoming more like a theology. My worldview is a biblical worldview. And my worldview is not complicated. Critical race theory is very complicated. And if you listen to people trying to explain it, it's all over the place. Here's what I will say. The Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 5, verse 6, that God said man's heart is continually evil all the time. As a matter of fact, it so hurt and offended him that that's where we got the whole flood from. But at the end of the day, God had grace because he knew what he had created was good. And that's what we're missing in the whole context. Does racism exist in America? Yes, it does. Why? Because man's heart is continually evil all the time. It's not rocket science. But we don't live in that place. We live above it. We press toward that mark that we're striving for. And that mark is the high ideal that Dr. King set for us, that we would judge each other by the content of our character rather than the color of our skin. We've gotta think higher. I mean, we don't wanna just kind of swim in the swamp of life. M. Scott Peck in the book Road Less Traveled starts off very first sentence in the first chapter, life is difficult. Period. He did not write that book for dark-skinned people or light-skinned people. That's just a fact. I don't care where you go in life, it's difficult. But how you overcome those values, those barriers, that's the measure of a man. And it has nothing to do with the color of your skin.
Perfect. What would Pearl say to an Ibram X. Kendi or someone pushing all of this stuff?
Yeah, she'd say, stop it. You're better than that. Stop it. You're not just the color of your skin. Who are you as a person? You're fearfully and wonderfully made by God. There's nothing without him that you cannot achieve. That's what she would say to them. Stop it, because it's not getting you anywhere. It's creating more division. And we don't need more division. We need more unity. And the fact of the matter is, my grandmother would say, we're more united than we are divided. We just don't stop and take the time to really appreciate it.
Ruth Edmonds for president. I'm sorry, Congress in Ohio. Although maybe one day.
Maybe
Ruth
one
Edmonds
day.
For Ruth Edmonds for Congress.com. Whether you live in Ohio or not, we need more Ruth Edmonds in positions of authority. But Ruth, it's a pleasure to talk to you. I know we'll do it again.
Thank you. I look forward to it.
Thank you.